Hello, multi-masked mountaineers, and thank you to Joshua Yeager. I was about to say Joseph, but it's Joshua Yeager for the malt mention. Thank you, Joshua. And welcome, malt fans around the world and beyond, to a ralfy.com whiskey review in which I'm reviewing a blended whiskey, not a single malt. It's been a while, isn't it? Pour a glass, small glass, not too small, not too big, just enough to have a blend moment, not a malt moment, a blend moment. The combination of single malts, one or more, with one or more grain whiskies, it's called a column still whiskies, which is essentially a mash bill. A traditional column distilled mixed mash bill of malted barley, corn primarily, because it's cheapest, perhaps wheat, maybe a drop of rye if it's needed. I think I'll try this neat first. Let's put the silver spoon back for the moment. That is what blended whiskey is. Most blended whiskey is predominantly grain whiskey, in which the malt flavour is balancing off to create something lighter and more orchestrated in terms of profile, flavour range and form. Interesting to note that the demand at auction for blended whiskies is not as high as it is for single malt whiskies, for a very simple reason. If you're going to drink whiskey over the from decades ago, you will find that malts seem to hold their character over time in the bottle better than blends. Unless the blends have got a lot of, say, peated whiskey in them, like White Horse, old White Horse blends, they're quite sought after because they contain lagavulin. And you will find that some old blends just fall to pieces in the bottle over time. Still sealed, of course, but when you come to open it, you can get wee cheesy notes in it. So it certainly doesn't have the durability over time that single malts do. And that would also seem to be reflecting in the demand now for drinking of blends. Still a big market, but by far the majority of conversation and interest globally now is increasingly moving away from blends to malts. It's part of the structure of globalization, the evolution that's happening so quickly all around us. It's fascinating to watch, because after a while of observing it, you can start to see the trends. Anyway, traditional blend here, Hankey Bannister, silly name. Where does that come from? I'm giving this a minute or two to settle down the glass. Beaumont Hankey and Hugh Bannister were two successful businessmen who, rather like a comedian double act, they simply kind of worked together, seemed to gel, and as businessmen were very successful. It would appear that Beaumont was the flamboyant showman one, and Hugh was the stay in the office and look after the facts and figures and the practicalities one. And it's often the way a business works. You can have the creative one and the administrative one. And what they did was they identified fairly early on, because they were based in the London market. And I mean, this company, the Hankey Bannister Company, goes right back to the 1750s. Even before whiskey appeared, they were involved in rum and other spirits from around the world, being based as they were on the banks of the River Thames. So basically they could see the boats coming in, the boats coming out, going out, and they knew from the transmission of communications from around the world, which were most accurately done by the gossip on the boats down in the local pubs, taverns and coffee shops. What was what? Where was the best rum being produced and all the rest of it? So they understood all these centuries ago that quality will always have a market. And that's one primary reason why the Hankey Bannister brand has survived so long is that it's a less well-known brand. It's rather like, another good example, Antiquary. It, you know, these are no Chivas Regals and Johnny Walkers. They don't have the massive marketing budget and push that these big brands have. These have got very little push behind them. And in fact, they're just waiting to be found. So Antiquary, I'm a big fan of Antiquary. I reviewed the 12-year-old not that long ago. It is most certainly a better value upmarket blend. The quality is in the smelling and tasting. You can tell that it's decent quality distilled spirit, both malt and grain. But not only that, the calibre of the casks being used are decent. And that is not what you can say for some more prominent blends at this moment in time. And that's an opinion. But this is one of these blends. The price range is quite good. They're not being pumped up, you know, at the moment the way malt prices are being pumped up because of supposed demand. We'll see how long that lasts. You know, this is an accessible, affordable, reasonably priced blend, which comes in a number of guises. You've got the original, which is a good mixing whiskey by any standard. You've got the heritage at 46%, which is actually quite a tasty blend and often overlooked. It's one of these sort of themed blends that's available at the moment. You've got this one, the Regency 12-year-old, bottled at 40%, as you can see, chill filtered, colour added. If they really wanted to overhaul their brand, they would simply keep the label, keep the box, and just put it 46% unchill filtered natural colour. That would nail it. That would absolutely nail it. In fact, it would be positively revolutionary. Not something that happens in the Scotch whisky industry. You can take my word on that. yeah. And it's got a lovely nose. There's no peat about it. This is not a peated whisky. It's unpeated whisky. It's quite toffeed and soft, naturally caramel. Vanilla, definitely. A little bit of brown sugar, muscovado. You can clearly see the slight ripe fruitiness and warm grain notes of a fairly decent blending grain whiskey, mixed mash bill whiskey. It's decent stuff. Totally inoffensive, hardly spectacular, not really in a par with what we would expect from malts, but hey, look at the price, it is a blend, let's give it some space here. It's being honest with us, and there doesn't seem to be, importantly, an awful lot of cask juggling going on with this, as you do get with some malts, which is, when you get experience with it, as you know, malt makes a little bit off-putting. You start to see the theme, you start to know what to expect next. Nice arrival, shame about the development. With this, there's a bit of transparency on the nose, on the palate. What have we got? Some fresh fruit, something slightly citrus, grain sour. Fresh, spirit driven, but rounded. A little bit of that toffee note coming again in with vanilla flavour. Decent, ubiquitous, jobbing, blended whiskey, which you'd be happy to sip. I'm going to add a drop of water now. Just a drop. Well, four drops. Give this a few minutes. You see, I've added very little there. Very, very little water. There's a reason for that. There are other bottlings by Hankey Bannister, which you see less of. There's the 21-year-old Partners Blend, which is really nice. 25-year-old, which is few and far between. And then there is the very good quality 40-year-old, which is quite expensive for a blended whiskey. But if it was a malt whiskey, it would be considered cheap nowadays. And bear in mind, with old blends of age, Once you get blends that are over 21 years old, you find it is the Scotch whisky industry's tradition and habit to have a much higher proportion of single malts in their blend, because they know the only people who can afford these bottlings tend to have more discerning palates, are probably sipping them neat, and therefore will be rather quick to point out to their vintners or spirit specialists if they're disappointed. I've added a drop of water. It's really tamed the nose. Well, four drops. It didn't take much. Very, very little. Makes a big, big difference at times with whiskey. It's really tempered this down. The fresh fruit notes are coming through. Some lovely, delicious, soft, confectionery banana notes. A little hint of pineapple in the background. A little touch of apricot floating about. Something slightly confectionery, but not sweet. The palate just becomes alive, becomes so much richer. At this point, having added a few drops of water and left it a minute, I could hand that to someone and say, which distillery do you think that comes from? Trick question, I know, but people would be convinced it's a malt. Sure, there is that slight brulee custard grain note. But nowadays, people tend to think that comes from the cask. You know, it's that virgin oak thing. So very easy to confuse that. And the development has got a little bit more body to it. And in the finish, there's a lovely little vanilla and gingery note. Something slightly confectionery, but dry, not sweet. So at a relatively young age of 12 years, and it's great, it's got an age statement. All good, seriously, all good. When so many blends just don't, so they can offer less for more money, less whiskey for more money. It's business, I'm not judging. It's just up to the consumer, as they like to call us, to be more discerning, and therefore, over time, apply more value for money to the purchases we make in bottles. Final taste. Lovely little creamy cocoa notes coming through now. A few drops of water, it's just growing, continuing to grow. The age is justified. You're tasting proper traditional 12 years of maturation. This isn't 12 years tasting like 8, or not 12 years tasting like 14. This is 12 years tasting like 12 years and a little bit extra. And it's just a lovely whiskey, which unfortunately is brought down. It's brought down by the chill filtration, for starters, and by adding, you know, look at it, it's got that apricot look, isn't it? It's got that fake tan glow. Now, if I was looking at a brand that was ripe for deluxe branding, to have a blend which can outpace a malt, all you'd do is you'd bottle it 46% unchill filtered. That's what you'd do. You just slightly dress up, a little bit more thought into the bottle's fine, but, you know, just put a cork on it instead of a screw top. And you're away. But 84 out of 100, it's a blended mark. And I have to say, my Patreon pals, bless you, thank you for your patience. I usually indicate what I'm going to be reviewing before I review, because if it happens to be a particular single malt that's going to get a high mark, occasionally it's going to sell out within a couple of weeks, if not sooner. Particularly if it's a single cask bottling. And of course my Patreon pals get the flag up if I'm thinking very highly. I never give out malt marks before the video, but I do intimate in photographs and give a general resume of what I'm thinking of a whiskey. an impression, a residual, an initial impression before I review it. But this has been a surprise for everyone because I've made no announcement about this. So Patreon pals will get 24-hour advanced video. And then it just goes for general release for anybody and everybody anywhere at any time to see. I'm Ralfy, whiskey review complete. If you pop back again shortly for Ralfy Review 744 Extras, I will be talking more about a little bit briefly about GMO following my last GMO monologue in Extra 742. But I'm going to take it further and I'm going to talk about whiskey fans' contributions and conversations online and how online is changing the game. Join me then. It will be interesting. Lovely to see you. Enjoy your whiskey and don't get pished. Bye-bye.